Wow! I'm ready!
Where are you?
Going to DJ's in my car! Beat out!
Hey, man, yo!
Woo!
Hello?
You gotta be smiling, you gotta be dancing, you gotta be shaking that ass!
Woo! Welcome to the top 10, maybe even top 2 podcast on all of the interwebs. Live from, well, recording from the Boken.
We're live personally. Live.
Personally, we're live. I'm your boy Z, and to my right is the always handsome, always beautiful, always inspiring,
always
soft
hungover.
And gentle Bonesy boy.
Super
Hello, Bones.
Super hungover, just like you were on Monday.
I had a struggle most of this week, and we came right into a struggle from you.
Oh, yeah. Real bad.
You went to Broj's last night for your work happy hour.
No, that wasn't the work happy hour.
Oh.
This was the after.
Post-work
happy hour. Because happy hour never lasts 1 hour. Work happy hour was 3 hours, 3.5. And then everyone's like, where should we
go? That's a pretty big commitment right there.
Yeah. And I was like, I just said Broj's. I was with a bunch of bros. And I was like, we're going to Broj's.
Broj's is the best bar in Manhattan. There's multiple of them, but it is by far the greatest place ever.
30th and Lex.
35th? Yeah, 33rd and Lex. 30th.
No, it's like
31st. It's right by the garden over there.
No, you're thinking of the one near Penn Station.
Oh, that's a different one.
They redid that. I think they put a rooftop.
Which
on that.
One's the one with the skee ball downstairs?
That's the one we went to.
Okay.
That's the only one I go to.
Clearly the best one by far.
There's one in Stanford. They're all over the place now.
They've franchised that. Yeah. New Haven, I believe, has one now. I've heard of Stanford.
I'm a little out here.
I'm not sure where else, but Broj's.
Interesting.
Fish bowls. Wonderful, wonderful.
Did not get a fish bowl.
Well, I feel like you can't. During the week, and especially you can't if you're with coworkers. I feel like it's a little weird.
I literally said I'm not coming in tomorrow to my boss at like 6:30, and he just goes, "Okay, all right."
Fish bowls are a bit of you'll get judged for having a fish bowl, and I don't know if that's the appropriate work drink per se.
I get hungover just from beer. That's fine. Like I will get hungover, and you throw some sugar in there, I throw up all day.
The fish bowls are pretty much pure sugar.
No dinner either. Didn't eat dinner again.
They didn't provide appetizers at your work happy hour.
No, we did, but I was drinking, so.
There you go.
You'll like this. I had a fried mozzarella stick.
Like just a mozzarella stick?
Yeah, a fried mozzarella stick.
It's just a mozzarella stick?
Well, no, I mean.
Why do you have to specify the fried mozzarella part?
Because I could get a stick of mozzarella. It's called string cheese.
Exactly. It's not called a stick of mozzarella cheese. It's just called string cheese, like you just said.
Do you string your cheese?
I think you just circled yourself out of the square.
Do you string your cheese?
Do I string my cheese?
Yes.
I don't even know what that means.
Like if you get a string cheese, I'm just going to eat this. I'm not taking the time to string it.
I do two pulls and then I get bored and I just start biting.
They do taste better when you string them. I don't know why.
What is that noise?
I don't know.
Oh, I must be on your Wi-Fi.
Ah.
Oh, never mind.
Welcome. It was your Wi-Fi at one point.
That's correct. I used to live here.
Okay, so yeah, I'm very hungover.
So I got a text from you at 3-something in the morning about
3 a.m.
about something to do on the show today, and as that was occurring,
I texted you at 3 a.m.?
Somewhere along those lines.
I don't remember that at all.
I had already actually went to bed and woken up and then gone back to sleep at that point because at roughly 1:30 this morning, I got hit in the face with a smell that was ungodly. It was the smell of cancer reincarnated into my dog who diarrheaed all over my floor. She, Carly
Carpeted
Ray.
Floor? Carpeted.
No, we have hardwood, thank God.
Yeah.
So Carly Ray, my dog, had been sick the last couple days, a little bit of a stomach bug, wasn't eating, yada, 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 went to the vet. We got her good. Everything was fine. And then last night, I guess early this morning, something must have just hit her, and oh my Lord. I was in a deep, deep sleep, and I woke up. I looked down at the floor because I thought I smelled something, and I was half asleep, and I looked at the floor, and it was just two large puddles of brown, and I looked at them. I was like, if I close my eyes right now, maybe this didn't happen.
They'll go away.
And then I closed my eyes. I opened my eyes, and I looked at Carly, who's back in bed with me, and she didn't have anything on the bed. There was nothing around her body, like no residue. So I was like, all right, maybe I just made that whole thing up. Maybe it was just chocolate ice cream. I don't know. I was getting Ooh. Crazy thoughts at 1 a.m. and then I looked back
chocolate down. Ice cream that smelled like shit.
Well, yeah. Then I looked back down and it was just two big puddles with a pee puddle running through the stream of both of them. It was absolutely
so whatever
vile.
The doctors gave her got it out.
Oh, it 100% worked. She hadn't pooped and eaten in like basically 48 hours. And whatever the doctor gave her, it worked times 10. I don't like having, what is like having a baby like? Like I woke up at 1 a.m. and I struggled through my day.
I don't know. My friend said their baby sleeps right through the night.
But you know how many, you ever hear those horror stories like, oh, my kid woke up like 3 times throughout the night. I had to go up and she pooped and she peed. I woke up once, just once to like clean up her shit at 1 and I struggled for the first 3 hours of my workday. I was like, oh my God, I can't even handle this. What's it like having a kid?
Well, I hopefully will never have to worry about that, but
I'm definitely sterile.
And so. I think it's for the good of all humanity that I don't have a child, but
we're a strictly non-procreating podcast.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. The amount of alcohol and other things I put in my body, definitely not working. Yeah, I mean, my friend said his baby doesn't cry, like sleeps through the night. They have a schedule set. Like his wife goes to sleep at like 7.
So
the baby goes to sleep. Well,
because
they have to feed the baby at like 11 ish.
Okay.
So then she wakes up and he stays up while the baby's sleeping until 11. They also have a, you know, this just to go off on that, they have, I think at 7 p.m., he said, they dim all the lights and like turn off the television.
It's like the quiet hours when we were at Quinnipiac.
Because they want to put her in her schedule.
Yeah. When it was finals week, they would dim the lights the whole time to like make you study or whatever.
What? When did that happen?
It was called quiet hours.
Where?
During finals week. In every dorm room.
What? Oh, I was just never, I didn't start studying until like 11 p.m.
But it was like all the lights were off the entire finals week and the week before because they wanted, and it was called quiet hours or study hours or something, and they wanted to encourage you.
That seems like the opposite. They should have all the lights on, as much loud sounds, because like if you're all the lights are off, you go to sleep, you fucked up, you didn't write your
morgue name. Hours. It was called morgue hours.
Interesting. That's also.
I could be wrong.
Didn't they brought in like a special coffee thing too, just for finals and midterms? Like they had that like coffee stand.
I vaguely remember they brought in a Starbucks stand because they got rid of the Starbucks stand at one point, and then they brought back a Starbucks just for that.
Interesting.
So. Yeah, I don't know how I'm going to have kids. Just waking up with a dog is enough for me right now.
And your dog doesn't even bark. It's like the nicest dog in the world.
Carly Rae is a saint. She is always in this room while we record, and like you never hear her. All you hear is her jingling.
Or me being annoyed because she's licking her under areas, her vagina, on my pillow.
She likes to lick various parts of her body. That is one of them.
Mm-hmm. I could just cut. The dead silence is fine.
I just love this button.
What are we moving on to here? We're going to... Oh, there it is. That's the sound we're looking for. Yeah.
All right, Bones. Ooh. I think the first thing we... Whoa. What is that?
I don't know.
All right, Bones. I think the first thing we got to talk about now... you told me to start watching this show.
Oh, yeah.
The Double Shot of Love with Vinny and Pauly D. I've talked to a few people. They're like, this is right up your alley. You got to watch it. You told me to. I binged the first 5 episodes over the last couple days. Holy shit. Is this the greatest reality TV show? It is by far a top 10, maybe even top 2 reality TV show of all time. It's hands down.
99% of these women have never been on TV before, which is not like The Bachelor and Bachelorette. Like all those shows, all the other dating shows, they've all been on different shows. And this is them. That's them trying to make it, so they get it. None of these women get it. That's the best part.
I literally wrote down when I was watching the show. I was just trying to take some like little notes here and there because I was catching up, so I could
doing
talk
your
to
homework,
you.
I see. I like it.
This show has like real girl, like real looking women on it.
Oh yeah.
Like there's not just 30 blondes who are like 5'7" that weigh 14 pounds that are from. I'm from Alabama, and I was a pageant show. This show is not that at all.
No, not at all.
These are all girls with curves, with fake eyelashes, fake boobs, big, big, big asses. We have every color, every nationality of the rainbow represented.
Mm-hmm.
It's awesome.
Yeah, it's great. You can tell that Pauly and Vinny love like Spanish and like Hispanic and black women.
They don't like just regular white chicks.
No.
But there is the one white girl. Her name.
The one with the Brittany? The one that has a kid?
Brittany.
Yeah, Brittany. Brittany.
She's a weather girl from like Iowa or something. Iowa, yeah. She sticks out like a sore thumb. Yeah. And that's good for her on the show because she's literally like the only normal ass white chick on the show that either isn't weird or. And
she has a child, though.
And she has like a 16 year old child.
I don't know if you heard this in there. Pauly has a child.
I knew that. He's got like a 5 or 6 year old. Yeah. I believe in his DJing days when he was in residency in Las Vegas. I think he had a kid with like a dancer down there or a bartender or a bottle girl. Like, again, anything we say on the show is pure speculation.
Yes, we don't really look it up.
We're not going to give you facts. No. Never.
But he does have a child. So you would think that's a good
relationship. Yeah, he does have a kid. That we can confirm.
But do you want to then marry a woman that also has a kid?
I mean, I don't think the kid is always with him. So that means you're kind of like getting a kid. If you already had the kid with you all the time, it would be like, all right, well, now we're just going to have 2 kids. If you marry someone with a kid who has custody of the kid, then you're getting like a kid like all the time. But it's not really a kid. She's 16.
Oh, yeah, that's right. She's almost an adult. So she had her when she was 17. So.
And she's like, yeah, she's only like 33 and she's got a 16-year-old kid. So like if you're going to marry someone who has a kid, that's the one to do because it's like your heart, like the hard part's done.
Who from Jersey Shore doesn't have a child? Who? Mike and Vinny.
Vinny just is about to get, Sam. Sorry, Mike's about to get married. Sam, we have no idea.
Mike's getting married? On. I thought he was in jail.
Mike's already married. He got married before he went to jail. The judge delayed his sentence.
It's like going to war. Before you go to war, you get married.
Yeah.
And then like you're miserable when you come back because your life wife most likely left you.
Ronnie just had the kid.
Wild. He's fucking
Sam. We don't know where Sammy's sweetheart, the sweetest bitch you'll ever meet. We don't know where
I've started following her
doing
on social media just to see if she like she doesn't really post a lot. It seems like, but like,
is she doing that well financially that she could afford to not do the reunion shows? Because like they made, I'm sure, like
a Ron, stop.
Like
Ron,
they definitely just backed up a Brinks truck for these people to come back. And like, how do you say no to that if you're her?
I mean, if you have a different life than that at this point.
All right. What's your number? So think about it like this. She didn't want to be there.
Maybe she invested in
Amazon. She didn't want to be there because of Ronnie, obviously.
Yeah.
What
they would have fucked 1,000%.
What number would you, like, what's the lowest number of money you'd expect? Or that
if
you would
I'm not
take?
Doing anything, I'm doing it. Like, I don't care how much money
but
I have.
I think she has, like, she's got, like, a new life. She's got a boyfriend or whatever. What's the lowest amount of money, if you're her, that you would take to go in there knowing that your life is going to be upturned and probably ruined again? Like, how many? Is it, like, $1 million? Is it $2 million? Is it
50K an episode sounds good. If they drop 20 episodes, that's
so
nice.
She got, like, $500,000. It clearly wasn't enough for her to potentially ruin her current relationship because she knows her and Ron would have a ridiculous like episode run.
Yeah. Tax free 50K an episode, maybe that. So then
tax free. Yeah. So like $1 million,
$75K an episode realistically.
I don't know. I guess no, her morality, did she 50%. Grow morals overnight? I guess.
I don't know.
But getting back into this show, by the way, if you guys aren't watching it, you need to, it's fantastic. We're there through episode 5.
Yeah.
And if you haven't watched it yet,
I'll give you Chris's DirecTV now password if you want. Only 2 people can use it. So
instead of giving a rose like on The Bachelor or whatever, they text the girls to come downstairs in groups or individually.
Z, Boke, and Z. Sorry, continue.
And they either tell them that their cab is here, which means they're being sent home.
No, that's just a play. Come down for the cab ceremony.
But then if they're going to be sent home, they tell them your cab is here. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they say that they're safe or like, can I have your number in the beginning? Whatever it is. Can I get your digits? And they text the girls these things. But by far the best part is when they're deliberating on who to get rid of, they have a haircut ceremony. Yeah. So Vinny and Pauly D literally have inside of the house, they have a barbershop that they go down and they give them each an iPad to flip through and like they talk about the girls that they want to get rid of or keep while they're getting their haircut every time they have an elimination.
It's absolutely fantastic.
We've seen 5 haircut basically like Sarah. It's like their pregame ritual.
They're just like living their lives. They just happen to be on the show. They're like, all right, let's go through these women right now.
It's incredible. But like, here's the thing. You know that during like The Bachelor and all these like quote unquote real shows they're trying to find love, you know they're giving The Bachelor, Bachelorette an iPad to swipe through the photos of people in the beginning with their names. They just don't show it. This show shows it. They want you to know that these guys are just like, whatever, we don't give a fuck. This is like, this is fun. We have no idea what these girls' names are. Like, none.
Yeah. And at the beginning of the show, the way they did it, they played that, they played a prank on him.
Prank what champion? prank what champion?
And think about, like, one went down as the host and the other went down as the bachelor. And for the shot of love, not the double shot. Think about how disappointed all the women were when Pauly D walks down as the host and Vinny's the bachelor.
Well, the one girl, Holly, was super pissed.
Yeah.
She was like, she knows everything that Pauly has done his entire life, and she's on this show.
She's been following him around. Like, he doesn't know this, but, like, everywhere he is, she's
there.
She's there.
And she's got a little bit of beef with people. She just constantly is saying the wrong thing. She's constantly putting her foot in her mouth.
Yeah. She questioned him on if he had cheated when he said, I've never cheated before. I don't cheat. And then she said, well, my friend who was a bouncer at whatever club said you cheated.
You're
on
doing
Auburn.
It wrong. It's my friend who has a bouncer friend. So what happened
yeah,
they were at Kama one night and I swear to God, you cheated on Aubrey.
Yeah. I mean, she's like, where is she? Long Island or Staten Island? I think she's Long Island.
Every girl, if they're not from Long Island, Staten Island, or New Jersey, they all look like
Long Island,
they're
Staten
like,
Island,
yeah.
Jersey, yeah.
They cast this show so perfectly. Even the only girl who doesn't look like she's from any of them is the tall, thin black chick who's from like the Bronx.
No,
so, like,
she's from Jamaica.
No.
Nikki? Yeah.
Nikki's no, no, Jamaica. Not Nikki. The one that's
the
with
one.
Vinny.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Vinny. The one with freckles.
Yeah. Yeah, so like the one that doesn't look like she would be from the Jersey Shore, besides the weather girl from Iowa with the kid, is this chick who's like literally from the Bronx. So like everyone either looks like they're from New York or is from New York.
Yeah, it's I love it. And the best is like the Staten Island, the one Staten Island girl that's gone. Cause did they even kick her out? I think she just left.
She left on her own the first episode within 20 minutes.
Yeah.
She was a hot mess. She was a bartender from Staten Island.
And Vinny just goes, I fucking hate girls from Staten Island. And yeah, I mean, he's from Staten Island, went to Staten Island College, which is, it's a great school. I think they call it the Ivy of the Island.
Oh yes.
Yeah. That's it. But yeah, he makes
CSI,
a good
point. Baby.
Yeah.
So to go through a couple of the chicks real quick, we had the crazy, I don't even know her name, but the crazy Christina. Yoga lady, Christina.
Yeah.
She was in the first like one or two episodes.
Yeah. She keeps showing up in different clips on the show.
She was insane.
And maybe they're doing that because she's so crazy. They're just going to
keep showing up.
Yeah.
She basically was like, I don't like girls. I don't have friendships with girls. And she was just talking shit to everyone, causing problems the whole time. She was basically feuding with every girl there.
Oh, when she danced on the floor, she was just, remember the dancing scene?
Oh,
when
yeah.
They go to the club in the house?
Just basically naked on the floor.
Yeah, she was just naked.
And then the girl from Long Island, I wrote this down, this quote. This girl from Long Island, I think her name's Marissa, she goes, they were beefing a little bit, and she goes, and I quote, I'm going to shove her namaste up her twat.
Yeah.
That's the girl you take home to your mother.
Oh, yeah. But she doesn't
know
how to cook.
A girl who said something like that.
Yeah. Vinny's, like, he's known, he says he's a mama's boy.
Yeah.
And she doesn't know how to cook, so that, I mean, like, she should have been gone right away.
You got that girl, Susie, who has the worst
laugh in the world. Oh, my God. I want to turn off. Oh, that's it. That's it. That's literally it. And fucking Pauly D loves it for some reason.
They made out on the Ferris wheel.
Yeah.
Oh, you could tell her, like, what's the weather outside like? She's like, like, bitch, I asked you a question about what the weather was.
Oh man, yeah. I fucking hate her. But look, they haven't... She was hanging out with
Nadia.
Nodley.
Now, Nadia, basically Nadia was just on the show to be friends with this girl, and then she got kicked off last episode, last night.
She had a big face. Her face did not go with her body.
Yeah, I wasn't a fan
of
Nadia.
Not that I'm one to judge. She had a great body.
I did want to see the two of them just be so dumb, though, for the rest of the episode, because in the last episode, everyone is downstairs. There's a big conflict with this girl, Nikki, and someone else. And the two of them.
Darren Page from Hoboken.
She's from
Bergen County.
I think it said Union City.
No. She's from Bergen County.
Oh, is Franklin Lakes? Is that
Franklin
her?
Lakes, yeah. And then she made out with Pauly.
Shout out the Flow area. So all the girls are downstairs basically arguing about this Nikki girl and Darren. And the two chicks, Susie and Nadia, are just upstairs. Just laughing, and then in one scene they're laughing so much, Susie just lets out a huge fart, like, and they like show it.
I didn't hear that.
Oh yeah, just huge fart lets out. The two of them, they needed to keep around for a little bit longer just because it was so entertaining.
Like, yeah, that was they were okay. I'm the Bee Lashes is fucking awesome though.
So I have a couple things about Bee Lashes. Now Bee Lashes is kind of just, she's called Bee Lashes. That's her name on the show. a lot of fake eyelashes. She's very Long Island as well. She's probably from like Massapequa or something like that. I don't know. But the girl Nikki's having a meltdown. And B-Lash just comes in and goes, look at this chick over here in her mob wife's coat.
It was, though. Oh, B-Lash is great.
And according to B-Lash's, for everyone out there, a public service announcement, leopard print is out. Shocker to the Guido community.
Yeah. Shocker to our friend Rick. He wears leopard a lot.
Rick loves leopard print. Yeah. But that took me for a girl like B-Lash's, who is, I could have sworn she was leopard print through and through. So good for her for, you know, standing her ground and saying that leopard print is out.
Yeah, leopard print is, I don't know, has it ever been in since like 1970?
Well, it's actually never not been in Staten Island.
Oh, yeah. Or Long Island, depending on where you are in Long Island.
So they had a hair gel challenge last episode, which was kind of stupid. They just literally were suspended over, looked like just water.
I think it was water.
It was just definitely water.
Well, what was the quote? Because the more hair gel you put in, the stronger it gets, just like a relationship.
Oh.
Yeah, it was a nice
corny. That was
corny.
Deep. That was deep.
It was a nice corny Pauly D quote. Carly, what the fuck are you doing?
So the hair gel challenge happened.
I liked it.
Now,
I'm shocked at how
long Vinny lasted for. Pauly's definitely in better shape.
No, Vinny's in better shape.
Really?
He's the keto Guido, bro.
Yeah, but that just means he's like lean. I think Pauly's like the strong one.
Do you follow them on any social media? You should, because he just did a no homo. He did a residency. I think he called her at Chippendales.
I heard about that.
Yeah, and he has a good body. He works out. I would figure Pauly because he's too much. He's just all muscle.
Yeah.
Like, he's going to get tired more.
He's a glamour muscle guy.
Yeah.
Now, that girl Derwin.
Darren.
Darren.
Darren Page.
She's from...
Maybe it's Derwin.
Burton County, Hoboken, etc. A lot of Jersey ties, so we love
it's
her.
Definitely not Derwin.
But she has, like, a weird cat fetish or something, and she was, like, crawling around on the floor in the first episode, which then prompted... This is why I love these two guys. Their sense of humor is so childish, because they made three or four pussy cat jokes like in a row. Like, this is why we love Vinny and Pauly D.
And then all the women loved it because that's what they've grown up to.
Yeah, we watch them on TV make these terrible like high school jokes forever, and we love it. And then the one thing I will say, this show like got such a low budget because
they're not dating anywhere. Their dates are in the show.
They've stayed in the house the whole time. You watch The Bachelor. They travel the world.
Yeah.
Like, well, other countries. They're in every state. They do these wonderful, extravagant getaways. They had a club called The Club in their house. That was one of the dates.
Yeah, and Pauly D did the DJing. They couldn't even pay for another DJ.
One of the dates was they put a rowboat in the pool. That was the date. That was a one-on-one date.
Yeah. Well, I said this. I think I tweeted this. I think if Darren and B-Lashes don't win, they should be on the next double shot. Like, they should just 100%. Continue. Double shot of love up out of women.
With those two.
But then you bring, like, B-list stars, male stars on that, like, didn't make it. On, like, guys from The Bachelor that got cut, like, just from all different shows, and then do that.
It would be the...
I'm like, cut this out and then send it to MTV right now. Be like, hey, just $10,000 for this idea.
Yeah, do this now.
Yeah. If you can just pay for a studio so I don't have to be in my room and someone to play with Carly for the whole time, that'd be great.
Let's do it. Yeah. The last thing I had, this is going to be probably a little racist, so we might have to cut this part. But
okay.
So Mish is the Asian chick.
She stinks. She's not, and I don't know why she's still there.
I'm sorry.
I feel like they feel bad for her, and they think that she might kill herself if she gets cut.
Mish, she's like a young Asian chick, but whenever she cries or gets upset, all I can see in my head and picture on the screen are like, you know, like those Asian
girlfriends that used to do that. Yes.
You know, those Asian cartoons where like the eyebrows get really raised and they're like, they like shrink the eyes real quick. This is a very racist thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, it literally looks like when she's sad that like a thought bubble is going to pop up above her with like the word ugh or something.
Yeah, no, I agree. And the best, do you remember the beginning of the show? She didn't know who they were.
Yeah, had no idea.
How is that possible?
She is 22. Like, this show was 10 years ago. Like, she was 12.
That's actually prime time for her to be watching Jersey Shore, man.
That's a good point.
And the show's still on. They have the Jersey Shore reunion. They have a ton of Jersey Shore. And then they had Jersey Shore when they went to Italy. Like, they've had a lot of Jersey Shore.
That's a good point.
There is no
reason.
You
gotta be living under a rock.
To not at least know who the fuck they are.
Yeah.
At least Pauly D, too. Like, I mean, he's very popular. He is an actual DJ. mad respect to him for like being like, I'm going to be a DJ and then being a DJ.
Well, we're going to end on this. I want her to win. And if she doesn't win, I think maybe B-Lashes. I think B-Lashes has no hope to win, but we love B-Lashes.
I think I kind of want them, if they plan on doing another show, I want them both to lose and then do a double shot of love with B-Lashes and Darren.
We know that Maria chick's going to go far.
Oh, yeah. Maria's so hot.
She's into weird porn, too.
Oh, that's like...
What a great opening conversation. Ooh. They just go right into porn. So
that was awesome. And like Japanese porn, like really weird, like tentacle porn that they were talking about. I would have like, if I were Vinny, I'd be like, I guess we're ending the show. Everyone else can go.
I choose you.
Yeah, Paulie, you can do whatever you want.
The other 19, Paulie, you choose between them.
I mean, why even wait here at this point? And Vinny's like, he's like very nervous around him all the time. Like he's not a famous person.
Yeah, well, he's an introverted kind of guy.
Yeah.
For being a celebrity, he's introverted.
Yeah, but he has a ton of sex.
Yeah.
Yeah. He even states that. He's like, yeah, basically just been having lots of sex.
Smashing.
Yeah.
Listen.
Smush room. Where's the smush room?
The Boken boys are 100% all in on this show.
Oh, yeah.
Double shot of love. We give it our stamp of approval. We got a caller on the line. Our good friend, Bob. He's going to hit us with a hypothetical. Bob, you're on.
Thanks, guys. First time, long time caller here.
fuck Mike Francesa.
In honor of the Kentucky Derby this weekend, I've got an interesting height question for you.
Okay.
Would you rather be the size of a Kentucky Derby horse jockey for the rest of your life?
What are we talking give me a height.
Like 4'9".
Okay.
Or you could be the size of one of those like freaky European guys in the NBA who are like
Boban. Yeah.
Like Boban.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So would you rather be 4'10" or 7'7"?
7'7".
Exactly.
Oh, fuck.
Bob, thank you very much. We appreciate your input.
I'm going to hang up and listen now.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. All right,
this is the first thing. Under 4'10 is a legal midget. You get a lot of perks with that. Parking, you can park in all the handicapped spots because you're technically handicapped.
Can't you do all these things if you're 7'7"? You definitely have a debilitating knee or back.
No, but there's no like a legal giant. That's not like a thing. There's like...
What if you have gigantism? That's a thing.
Yeah, I guess that is. But like, if you have gigantism, you die like at 20 because like you can't stop growing and then your body just like breaks apart.
So maybe that's what this comes down to. Would you rather be 4'10 and live probably a really long... Actually, no, you're little. Your organs are small.
Throw something in there too. You have a big cock at 4'9". You have your cock now at 7'7".
Oh, that's tiny.
You can just use your cock now in either situation.
Either
because
way,
it's huge.
Sucks.
It's huge at 4'9".
Oh, I guess. Yeah, well, comparatively, because you're so little. Bad.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Wait, I don't know. I don't know if there's a clear... I want to say that the clear answer is 7'7".
Clear answer is 7'7".
I want to say that, but I could easily be swayed into... Like, Vern Troyer had a dope-ass life, and he was even shorter than that.
No, he was an alcoholic.
I mean, like... All right, that's a good point.
Yeah. You're thinking more of like, what's his name from Game of Thrones?
Tyrion Lannister.
No, what's his actual name?
I don't know. I'm drawing a brain freeze.
Who used to be a waiter at Charlie Brown's in Chatham, New Jersey.
Correct.
And the only reason I remember that is my parents were like, hey, have you seen the waiter from Charlie Brown's on Game of Thrones? I'm like, oh, shit, that's right. He's
being short, though, like, you're never going to get a girl. Take away the penis situation aside, you're never going to get a girl.
Never?
Like, like I said, you're going to get the only type of girl that's going to be into you is some weird fetish, like 6'8", 400-pound girl that you'd find on like the Maury show and you see this couple together.
I don't know. There's social apps and dating apps now.
I mean, you're 4'10".
Yeah, but I mean, I don't know. There's somebody for everybody. You know, they say that.
Exactly. If you're 7'7", like, think about... All right, just think about it like this.
What if you're 4'9", and you have... whose face do we want to say on there? Ryan Gosling's face. Your body is Ryan Gosling, but you're 4'10". You're just a small...
I guess you'd fit into some weird, like... young fetish
porn?
Thing.
You can instantly get into porn.
But think about it, like, just in regular life. Think about how many tall, ugly guys are married or dating smoking hot chicks. Just, like, being tall is a huge advantage.
Oh, absolutely. Like, it is. Women, for some reason, have this their mindset on, I need a tall guy.
Yeah. They just feel safe and secure with you.
Yeah.
Boban, who we're basing this off of, has, like, a smoking hot girlfriend or whatever.
He's
he might be the ugliest person that's on the face of the earth.
He's hideous.
Like, he's but he's awesome. We love Boban. Yeah, but he's hideous.
His stretching is incredible. Incredible stretching. He almost does a split. He's like fucking incredible when he watches.
He's very
him
limber.
Yeah.
I don't care what it is. I'm taking the 7'7". I can't go short. Maybe it's because I'm short myself and I've been short my whole life. I just want to be tall.
Yeah.
And I just want to be a good basketball player.
Yeah. Oh man, you're taking.
I'm taking the small guy.
I'm looking like Ryan Gosling at 4'9" with my cock now.
Either way, the health implications are terrible. If you're tall,
you have a short
lifespan. Too large of an organs. Correct. If you're little, you have like little cat and dog organs, so you're going to die quick either way.
Correct. Okay.
I think I'd rather die being the tall guy in a blaze of glory, though.
Okay. All right, we'll leave it at that. And I'll just throw an Inception button. Yeah, but boom.
I need to play it.
He needs to play it. Boom. Is that it?
All right, Bones. So one of the things that we had happen over the last few days, I don't know, you want to describe the D'Angelo Russell drama that's going on?
Yeah. Yeah, so he went to get on a flight, brought weed with him, put it in one of those fake safe containers that was an Arizona iced tea can, which it seems like a good move, except you can't bring liquids onto a flight. So
and it
they
was clearly too much of a liquid.
Yes. So they obviously they took the can, went to throw it out, and were like, wait a minute, opened it, and there was fucking weed in it. Because it's just a twist. It's not like a secret compartment. It's not like there's Arizona iced tea in it. It's literally like you just open it up, and it's a container full of weed. So that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Like, you can't bring through security, cannot bring liquids. Once you get through, go fucking buy one of those and take the weed that you stuffed up your butt and put it in. But that was very, very dumb. It should make it real easy to sign him for cheap, though, if you think about it.
Correct.
That way.
This is great for the Nets. Really you might good get for him at a little bit of a discount now. Maybe he had the cell phone incident with Nick Young where he blew up Nick Young in Iggy Azalea's spot.
Oh, yeah.
That was strike one. This is strike two. Maybe the Nets are a forgiving franchise, so maybe they get him for a few million dollars less just for their support.
Or he's going to Denver because, you know, weed's legal.
So now anything with any NBA player, you know, is just going to enter in the beautiful opinion of Stephen A. Smith, who famously, who was it that the original?
I don't remember.
Either way, he's a very hot, he has a take on athletes, and he always says, stay off the weed, duh, when referring to athletes.
When they've smoked weed and got caught for it,
So when
probably,
this
it was probably Josh Gordon.
Probably.
It was
definitely Josh Gordon. So when this news dropped yesterday, the entire world and internet were just waiting with bated breath for Stephen A. Smith to drop his comment. And he is a self-conscious person, and this is what we had. He delivered.
Go ahead, Stephen.
Well, first of all, I have to say the obvious, Max. Stay off the weed.
Oh.
I have to say that.
Wow, it's just
he went for it. Yeah. He took it to a level 10. Well, it was awesome.
This content has just made him more popular than he's been in when it was Stephen A. and Skip. Was Skip Bayless? Yeah.
Yeah, Skip was the original part. Now he's got Max Herpy Lip Kellerman.
Yeah, Max Kellerman. Was Max Kellerman farted? Max Kellerman farted.
Probably.
Was it Max Kellerman? Who was it?
Max Kellerman, like, you make all that money. There's got to be a way. And you have a whole makeup crew. How do you not just contain your herpy flare out? You're on national TV every day.
Maybe he had it. He fucked someone from the makeup crew. She didn't cover it up intentionally, knowing that he doesn't pay attention when they're doing it or talk to them. Maybe
she's
that
guy. She's blackmailing him. And she says, you have to go out there every day. Like, your scarlet letter will be your herpy. Otherwise, I'm going to tell everyone what you did to me.
Yeah, maybe.
Probably not, but that would be funny.
Yeah, that would be great. That'd be hysterical. He's like, fuck. All right. And he farted on TV. He held it. He should have just farted. It's the sound he tried to make after he farted.
The moral of this story was the Nets are going to get D'Angelo Russell for cheaper.
For real cheap. Yeah.
All right, Bones, this is one of your personal favorites up next, and I'm just going to let you take the floor. Mike Francesa.
Oh, boy.
Go for it.
So he called into Boomer and Geo in the morning, and the best part is they start out, they're like, this guy says he's Francesa. I don't think he is, but he sounds very much like Francesa. And Geo and Boomer are like, all right, let him speak.
There are a lot of people who do a great Francesa impersonation, so it wouldn't be that hard or... It wouldn't be that unlikely that someone would jump in with it.
Oh, yeah. But it was 1,000% him. They were like, once they started talking, it's like, oh, yeah, it's you. He's like, yeah, this is me. He's like, this is Mike. He's like, oh, you're calling. He's like, I didn't even think you listened. Like, that's Boomer said that right away. and he just went off on a tangent about how, because he said some shit about the Giants. Well, nobody's going to interview with him from the Giants anymore, which is really, really going to hurt his number one rankings.
Eli pulled out of his weekly chat.
Gettleman will never do it. None of the owners, none of the mayors will ever do it. So he's fucked there. But he said about the sixth round pick that got shot. He questioned his background and his what is the word here? Well, he just questioned his character. Yes, and then after it all came out that the shooters were like not related to them at all, not friends with them. They were just outside. Him and his friend were outside. Of a party, but it was after he got drafted, so reasonable thing.
It was a women's soccer party.
Was it a women's soccer party?
College soccer party.
Which he's in college, or about to be out of college. Yeah, and congratulations. And then he got shot, and his friend died, and it was a terrible situation. And he's fully going to recover and going to make it to rookie OTAs, which is great.
And nothing about the situation said that he was doing anything wrong, or not even in the wrong place at the wrong time. It was just, it seemed to be just, he literally was in the wrong place at an unfortunate time. He was in the right place at an unfortunate time.
So Mike commented on that, and then he had to backtrack and say something else and like act like he never commented on it, and say he has a great character, not saying apologizing for that. Then he also called Gettleman a liar, said it was the worst draft, I believe, in like the history of the Giants. This is terrible.
He might have a point.
dropped some Trump tweets with like losers and we suck and all that shit. And then Gio and Boomer, you know, one day talked about it. And they were like, oh, Mike's just like losing. It talked about him. And he went on a tangent saying, you're cutting out the quotes from me. You're making stuff up. You're not listening to what I'm saying. And Boomer and Gio just sat there quietly, let him go on a rant, asked him a couple questions. And Gio was like, well, I didn't hear this or yet. I was like, didn't you say this, Mike? And like, they didn't fight back with him. They just let him go on a tangent for 10 minutes. And then afterwards, they're like, wow, huh? He's kind of mad. And Boomer's like, well, another listener, though. That's good. And then that was it. It was great.
You don't become number one without having some fire and some hot takes.
Yeah.
And that is Francesa.
Yeah. It was, he's going down. He's burning right now. He should never have come back. He was fine when he retired 4 months ago.
And he would, he'd pop in random places, do his little shtick. People loved it. Francesa Con is a thing where everyone dresses up like him down the shore at Bar A.
Just dress.
And it sells out. It's like a big thing. Yeah.
Dress with oversized, clothes, button downs.
He's doing an MJ when he came back. That's what he's doing right now. And I'm not sure, it's producing a lot of good viral content for everyone.
Oh, yeah. Real good.
But I'm not sure this is the best thing for his career.
No. I think his app. I don't know. I think they decreased the price on the app from like $9.99 a month to $7.99, I believe.
From the creator of Fantasy Football just 2 years ago.
He created Fantasy Football. That's right. Oh, no. He created Daily Fantasy.
Daily Fantasy. I mean, people forget he created it.
He created Daily Fantasy. It's pretty.
Listen, what do you think about this? All right. Jason Giambi on the line.
Oh, yeah. He loves Jason Giambi. All right. Go ahead. Let's. Do you have anything else to say there?
That's my Francesa. That's your Francesa.
All right. Okay.
Is so boring.
No, he's not.
I'm not a big Tom Hanks. He's like okay. He's like
cast
the most.
Away?
He's like the most vanilla guy you can cast in a movie.
He has
in our current PC culture.
What about Turner and Hooch? That's a great movie.
Like Forrest Gump. Like I'm not saying he was bad. I'm just saying like at this point, like he's so vanilla.
Pretty much every movie he's ever done has been good. Has been like
I'm not saying
acclaimed.
That. I'm just movie. Saying he's a good actor. I'm just saying he doesn't move the needle for me.
Lieutenant Dan, ice cream.
He's had great roles, but like, if he's your lead actor, are you expecting to get like some
Lieutenant Dan
thriller kind of movie, or you're just going to get like a really well acted, good story that's going to make you feel good about perseverance at the end of the day?
It could be. It could be anything.
You're not going to get like, he's not going to play a child molester who is like a mastermind villain or something like that.
Didn't he play, wasn't he the captain in the movie where I'm the captain now?
Yeah, he was captured by the captain.
Yeah, yeah. I'm the captain now.
All right, so he was clearly the good guy in that.
That guy won like best supporting actor, I believe, too. Yeah, he was a good guy. Yeah, he's not a bad guy.
His name had something with clicks in it. I don't know what it was.
Yeah. All right. My favorite segment. I didn't bring anything with me today.
Good.
In my apartment, but I could make you eat. I do have stuff in the fridge left over.
I would rather leave.
So we can do carb on carb here. I'm going to bring up a specific meal and from a specific place and see if Chris would ever eat it.
Okay, I'm listening.
So this is not in Hoboken. This is in Brooklyn.
Okay.
Vinny's Pizzeria. Great.
I have not been.
Yeah, I haven't been either, but I follow them on social media, and I always tell myself I want to go, but it's a fucking pain in the ass to get there. You got to like take the fucking, G train or something when you get to Brooklyn that only goes in Brooklyn.
That's a thing, yeah.
Yeah.
It's the new line over there.
So follow them on social media, though. They're great. They have a pizza where they put slices of pizza, tiny slices, mm-hmm. on top of the pizza.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ooh, this is a tough one, actually.
Yeah. So it's just a normal plain
carb
pie.
On carb.
It's just, yeah, it is.
I'm going to say no, and only because of this. Would you consider a Big Mac a carb on carb?
Based on your definition?
It's technically just part of the sandwich. It's technically two different sandwiches. You just consume it as one.
Technically, it's not, though. It's only three slices of bread.
But it's two different sandwiches.
Well, it's the same sandwich on top. So it's like a triple decker.
This is tough.
Yeah. It is a carb on top of a carb.
To be honest
with you. It's like taking a slice of pizza and flapping it on top of a slice of pizza.
That I wouldn't do. See, like
that's what they're just tiny cut pieces.
A pizza sandwich is definitely illegal.
Every slice has like three small slices on top of it.
I feel like I'm going to say no. And only
you said yes to start. So you're
no, I said I think I might like it. But now that I'm thinking more about it. You're still having like enough. I don't want the bottom of the pizza in the middle of my bite. I want the bottom of the pizza on the bottom of my bite.
What do you mean?
Like the bread part has to be on the bottom. So I can't also have bread in the middle, like the whole crust part and everything.
Yeah, I know, but there it's not in the middle. It's not in the middle.
It would be. There would be the bottom of the pizza, the sauce, the cheese, then the next bottom of the pizza. That would literally be in the middle of my entire bite. I don't want that. I'm out on it.
You're out on it? I'll show you a picture after this.
You almost had me, but I'm out on it.
I almost had you. I think you're going to be back in on it.
You're getting better. You're getting closer. You're getting warmer, but I'm out on it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm going to bring ones in that definitely you'll say no to, but...
I would separate the pizza off the other pizza and then eat it.
I'm going to... Once we decide what day exactly we're doing, I'm literally going to buy it. And
fine.
When we start this segment, I'm going to...
defiantly pick it apart like an asshole.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense. Will you eat it, though, after you take it off? Like, if there's...
Yeah,
fries
eat
on
it
a slice.
Separately.
So if there's fries on a slice of pizza, or if there's those slices on top of the pizza, you're going to take those slices off, eat
Correct.
Them, and then eat the slice.
What's the difference between that's just eating three slices of pizza? There's nothing wrong with that. Just because they touched the thing at one point doesn't mean it's wrong.
What if you only had 5 minutes to eat it? Not even 5 minutes, 1 minute. And you had to eat the slice. You can't take them off and then eat them and then eat the slice.
I just wouldn't eat it then.
No, you have to eat it.
Or what?
Or I throw my computer out the window.
All right. Wow, I'm really being punished here.
Yeah, well, and then this doesn't happen. All right, that's carb on carb.
Real quick, we're going to go a very old throwback to anyone from the Amanda Hug and Kiss Dades, AHK all the way, love you. The UrbanDictionary.com, word of the day. We're going to highlight a beautiful one today. The word is mung.
Mung.
For those of you who don't know what mung is, here's the definition. The one thing worse than genocide. One must first have no shame. Then he or she must put a newspaper to find or get a newspaper to find the obituary of a recently deceased man or woman. Then find a buddy, also with no shame, who will aid them in this act. The partners then go to a cemetery where they dig up their victim and flip a coin. The loser or winner, depending on how sick you are, applies his or her upper lips to the genitals or anus of the corpse.
Oh my God.
While the other partner proceeds to climb to the nearest tombstone and elbow drop the corpse's stomach, which forces out a blend of rich bodily fluids and embalming material onto the partner. The blend is called mung. The act of getting this blend on your face is called munging.
Munging. Oh, my God.
Chicks will dig this one.
Oh, man. This is a This is an interesting one. Can you use it in a sentence?
Sadly, there's no Hmong sentence given, but sure.
There's no Hmong sentence? Oh, man.
Well, Hmong is the physical properties
like,
of it.
Like, dude, do you have some Hmong on your face?
Correct. Yeah, that would be the Hmong. It's the blend of embalming.
See, what'd you do last weekend?
I went Hmonging, or no.
Yeah, you went Hmonging.
I went Hmonging and had some Hmong.
Mm-hmm. You got the Hmong out, yeah. So it has to be a freshly killed body, right? Like a freshly buried body.
Because otherwise it'll just secrete out.
Correct, yeah.
That's why you have to get your newspaper and open up to the obituary section.
Okay.
To find a freshly dug body.
Yeah. And you'd preferably want it, because they don't put the bodies in right away. Like, they have the ceremony, and then you walk away. At least the ones I've been to, which is fucking very dark. Not Hmonging, that's not dark. then you go and they're just up there, and then you can just open the casket when nobody's around to take it out. And, you know,
how much money would it take for you to,
I don't know if there's a number,
be on the get the Hmong on you?
I don't think there's a number.
How much would it cost for you to do the elbow drop? It's still a depraved act.
Yeah. Yeah. No,
nearly as like disgusting, but you're still digging up a dead body and elbow dropping it.
I'm going to, you know, I'll go 500K, maybe a mil, 500 to a mil. A mil would be nice.
There's no repercussions. You won't get arrested. What's your number?
500K.
If there was no repercussions, I'd do it for probably like 20 grand.
20 bucks? 20 bucks?
If I knew that I wouldn't get caught and there's nothing bad that would happen and the people's family who I'm elbow dropping wouldn't care, I'd probably do it for like 20 grand.
20 grand, huh? That's it?
And you don't have a number for being the recipient of the
money? Does that even pay your debts?
No, definitely
okay,
not.
You should probably at least get up to your debts being paid.
Yeah, it does sound like I'm just doing it for pleasure then.
Yeah.
How much would you be? There's no money, no
there's
dollar
not
amount
a number for
to
me
be
to
the recipient of the money?
Stick my fucking face on a butthole and...
No one... All right, how about this? No one will ever find out about it, including the person who does the elbow drop. They do the Men in Black thing. So the only person in the world that knows...
I don't want the Men in Black thing. I don't want to know that I did that. I don't care about anyone else knowing.
$50 million.
I think about it.
Boom.
That was a good one.
All right.
I like that a lot.
Next up, I'm throwing it right to you, Bones. You've been watching the new show on Netflix called Bonding.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
I'd love to hear about it.
All right. So Netflix is, I feel like they're going heavy Me Too. So this show, real quick, I've only watched 2.5 episodes because I had to turn it off in the third. It got so gross. It's a show about a girl in college, paying for her graduate degree in psychology, I believe. Master's degree, just doing this. She's a bondage queen.
Okay.
And she has a friend. They're both this girl and her gay friend from Ohio. He joins in on it. And by joins in, he's like her assistant. Apparently bondage queens or bondage mistresses require an assistant. He's like the bodyguard, but he couldn't be a good bodyguard. He's like a tiny...
For all you millennials out there looking for a job, there's plenty of these out available.
There fucking are, apparently. And she gets paid a fucking shit ton of money. So first episode, they go right into the bondage. Like, literally drop you into her... I can't even describe it. Just fucking beating the shit out of a guy. And then it goes into like some story, and at the end of the episode, it's the guy's there, and he's learning how to be mean, because people that are getting tied, they pay her to tie them up, and then she goes and like does whatever they say, but it's got to be mean. So he had to demean this guy's dick size, and he did it really, and he's a stand-up comedian as well, or aspiring one, and he did it really well. It was pretty hysterical, but then the guy starts jerking off, and you don't see him jerking off, but you see the movement, you know he's jerking off. And all of a sudden, the camera pans to her assistant, and when the guy comes, it's just a load on his face. And that's how they end episode one. Like, he walks out, like, you just see the kid smiling, too. He's like, wow, I actually got this guy, like, really turned on, and then just load on his face.
Oh.
And he walked out, and the end of the episode was like, I don't think I'm ever want to do this again. Like, which is a logical response to having someone jerk off and then come on your face.
Definitely. Oh, God.
Quick, going into episode two, bunch of storyline plot. End of the episode, that same guy that she's tied up likes this kid, and he wants him to pee on him. So he pees on him.
I feel like that's a standard bondage fetish.
He said no for a long time. He's like, come on, I want you to pee on me. And then her question was, do you want it on the chest or in the mouth today? And it doesn't show you him actually peeing. Well, it shows you from a bandage and from behind. I don't know if it was the chest or the mouth. So he fucking pee-pees on him. But he has to sing a song to get himself to pee. When I stopped watching, and when most people would stop watching, I would assume, third episode, halfway through, he has a roommate. He did this to pay for rent. He has a roommate.
As that's one very, does.
He tells about it. And the guy was like, I wonder what it's like. He's like, I've never had a finger stuck in my ass. And they have this conversation about it. And his girlfriend, his roommate's girlfriend, will not stick her finger in his ass. So this kid, this guy convinces him to stick a finger in his ass.
No.
And it goes like, it turns into he sticks another finger in his ass.
What?
And like is just fucking fingering his asshole.
Like going for the prostate?
Oh, man. Like real hard. And it got real sexual. And I turned it off. And that was it. I was like, this show is very aggressive, and I'm going to stop watching now.
So. For anyone that's thinking about watching that show, you don't have to now.
Yeah.
And please don't, because I think I got through 11 seconds of it, and then I was just like, what am I doing? And I exited out of it.
Yeah, no, it is one hell of a drop by Netflix there. And I'd like to see what season two.
They're expanding their catalog, Bones. That's all they're doing.
Yeah, fuck.
The Jesus. Kink community is now on board. They're Netflix brand loyal.
Oh, I'm sure there will be a ton of people. There will be a cult following for that show.
Ugh,
okay, I'm done with that. I don't want to talk about it ever.
All right, this is going to be a little weird. Bear with me and stay with me. A little
bit
strange.
Who are you pointing at?
It's going to get dark quick, but trust me, there's going to be a payoff. You know, there's been a lot of mass shootings lately, right?
Oh boy,
all these crazy guys shooting up synagogues and schools and stuff.
Okay.
We are an anti-mass shooting podcast.
I would fucking hope so.
What if, now, we wouldn't be able to glorify this, so we would never have to tell them, but what if, their punishment, instead of just going to jail, we put all the mass shooters on Guantanamo Bay and made them play the Hunger Games?
Great idea.
But here's the problem. You can't tell anyone about it because then there'd be a lot of like sadistic ass.
Oh my God, yeah.
People shooting people just to go to Guantanamo
to be in the Hunger Games.
To be in the Hunger Games, but
and the other issue here is there's a lot of the mass shooters are killed or kill themselves after they do the mass shooting.
Correct.
So you're gonna there's one this kid who this fucking kid tackled him and got himself killed and saved a lot of fucking people.
Yeah.
This kid survived because they held him down after that, but. And congrats to, not congrats, but like thank that kid.
Good job.
That's incredible. It's going to be like 1 to 3 people over the next, however many.
All right.
Years.
But think about it. Like we throw them on Guantanamo Bay.
Oh yeah. Totally down for that.
And we could even expand this. Like the problem is like no one will ever know about it because if you like, you can't glorify it.
I mean, this is literally what they did in Roman times.
Yeah.
In the Colosseum. They would just throw people in there and let them fight to the death.
I wouldn't be upset if like people that had life sentences just had the option to go do the Hunger Games stuff.
Oh no, they don't have the option. We decide.
But I'm saying like you give them you could go do it, but they have to know that they can't walk out of Guantanamo alive. So they're literally killing themselves, but it's in a more non-humane way because they're going to get killed by someone else.
How about this? So since we have so many, I'm just getting off the Hunger Games with this.
Okay.
Unfortunately, in the United States, there are a ton of fucking mass shootings. Those people, the guys that live, you take the mass shooter's dead body and you make them mung it. You're munging the dead body. And then you send him to jail for the rest of his life. And you show that video on repeat.
Like
every
this is what single we do to
day.
Mass shooters.
Every single fucking day to that person.
We make them mung.
We make them mung. And you take it's a mass shooter's dead body, so nobody feels bad about that.
Everyone has a breaking point, and I got to think that psychopaths that shoot people, their breaking point has got to be munging.
Yeah, it's the mung. Yeah, you don't want mung anywhere near you.
Oh!
There we go. That's a nice big cutout over there.
All right.
Fucking munging.
We're up to quick hitters.
Quick hit up.
Headline. Mom flees to Mexico following a homicide charge after her son, 5, died falling of a rental scooter that she recklessly drove into traffic.
So These rental scooters are the Lime scooters that our lovely city of Hoboken, New Jersey, is about to do a 6-month test run of. And it's not like
I do a, not like these.
Yeah, it's not a scooter you can have like two people on. This is a it's a one person thing. It's a fucking one leg. It's you have your 2 feet on it, and that's all that can fit.
You don't really fly around in them that much either.
No. And she was driving into fucking oncoming traffic and tried to swerve, and the other car tried to swerve, and he fucking hit the kid, and the kid died. Terrible. But I can absolutely see that happening in Hoboken.
Oh, 100%.
Their traffic here is fucking crazy.
There was that guy that one time that drove down Bloomfield Street and hit like 64 parked cars.
Yeah, 64 cars, yeah.
Just drunk, just driving down the side of the road.
Until he finally crashed his car. It was incredible. And that guy lived in Union City, which is right behind. You could have just walked home, bro. Like, what are you doing? Yeah, so this is, like, I kind of want to send this to, like, the Hoboken City Council and be like, this is why you shouldn't fucking do this. And the other thing is, like, they're not allowed on sidewalks. I'm like, that is not possible. How could
you
not
allow them?
Where are they going to fucking go? They're not going to be in the road.
There's only bike lanes on our main road in Hoboken, yeah. Like the main couple roads. And there's a lot of side streets that have nowhere to go.
And people double park in those bike lanes. There's no reason. It is, everyone rides on the sidewalks. They're going to be on the sidewalks. It's going to be terrible. And this situation will happen.
I was just in Austin, and they have them all over the city of Austin.
Okay.
And they are littered everywhere.
Oh, like, yeah, because you just leave them, and it just stops running.
In the middle of, like, everywhere. They're just scooters.
There's some towns in Jersey that have them. I've seen them. And I'm like, what the fuck is this? Somebody leave their scooter here?
Like, a couple of our friends brought it back to the Airbnb we were at, and you just leave them on the front lawn. Like, it's weird. But then we were walking on the sidewalk, and you have to literally walk through them and around them. They're just everywhere.
Well, yeah, apparently they just don't want people walking anymore. Just like, yeah, get on this fucking scooter.
Yeah. Very dangerous. I don't know. This is going to be a terrible idea for Hoboken.
And like, Austin makes sense because the winters are not like they are here. What are they going to do with them in the winter?
I'm most concerned. What are the homeless people going to need to do with them? Because people find a way to, like, ruin or destroy or make everything disgusting. What are they going to do with these scooters?
Oh, yeah. Well, they're going to ride them around, that's for sure. What's a dollar?
I think
it's
yes.
a dollar for an hour
it's like
or something.
A dollar and every quarter of a mile you go or something, or it's timed. I'm not sure.
Yeah. I had just quickly going to homeless people. There was a homeless guy that on the subway the other day that said, I know a lot of people don't carry cash. You can Venmo me. And I'm like, what the fuck?
So you got a phone.
You have a phone and you have a bank account then, because that's the only way you can get Venmo is connecting it. Like, to get that money, it would have to be linked to a bank account. So that's like that's a terrible sell right there. It's like, oh, you have money. You're okay. All right. I'm done with the homeless rant.
All right. Next up, we have headline is Millennials' Health Plummets After the Age of 27. Study finds the generation has unprecedented rates of diabetes, depression, diabetes. And digestive orders.
Diabetes. Yeah, that makes sense. I don't know. It's like, I can definitely feel after 27, my health greatly deteriorated. And it's just more of like, you feel it when going back into drinking. It's like the next day, like you need a day. You need 2 days. You're fucked up. Like walking up 5 flights of stairs every day. Like I'm like out of breath sometimes. Like when I had to carry the fucking,
And
you see,
the dietary stuff has got to be a direct result of everyone and their mother having an allergy of everything. Carb. Yeah, carb on carb. Everyone has a peanut butter allergy or a gluten allergy or this allergy or I can't eat tomatoes or I can't do this.
Tomatoes.
And I can't do that.
Yeah.
Like, most of it's made up. Like, when you talk to older people, they said, yeah, you know, like when I was a kid, I used to get like breakout in hives when I had peanut butter. So my parents force fed me peanut butter until I got over it.
That's fucking stupid.
That's what used to happen. I mean, unless you had like a deathly allergy, if you had like a little flare up, your body adjusted.
Never heard that. No, your face is swelling. Let me give you more.
Well,
of what you
I'm
just
not.
Said.
I'm saying obviously, if you were like going to the hospital, they're not going to do it. But if you had like, you got a little allergy, you kept eating it. Your body learned how to at least tolerate it. The problem is if you don't let them have any of this stuff, they're going to die.
Yeah.
The first time you like the most lethal thing to some of these millennial kids is like a little scoop of peanut butter.
God, fucking kids suck these days. And they all want trophies.
I was just walking my dog like 10 minutes ago, and I did tell you, I'm going to tell you this now. There's three little kids with their father, and they're walking down the street, and the little kid.
Did he have a ponytail by any chance? Because I saw
no.
The guy. Okay, continue.
Kid couldn't have been a day over 10, and the father is probably like 40. And he looks up at his dad and goes, well, you hit puberty like
so long ago, though.
That was the only.
It's a great.
That's all I heard in the conversation.
Kids can be funny.
And I was like, oh my God. Yeah. I was like, I don't want to know anything else that's going on.
How did that start?
I don't know. I didn't even make eye contact with the father because I knew it would just been awkward. I just put my head down and pretended like my dog needed to
like, was he talking about sex? And like, you know, why? Maybe his kid was asking him why his weenie gets hard.
He was clearly a young kid.
Why his weenie was getting hard. That's probably why. And his dad was like, fuck, you're hitting puberty. He's like, how do you even know what that's like? You hit puberty so long ago.
That's puberty, daddy. Yeah.
Oh, man, those fucking, you know, 10-year-old, 11-year-old, 12-year-old bonies we used to get. Dude, when you couldn't control them, when you had no control.
Tuck them in the waistband, bro.
The tuck. If you don't know the tuck, you have some fucking serious issues.
You didn't have an older brother or someone to look out for you, that means.
Yeah, I mean.
Or you were just dumb and couldn't figure it out.
Yeah, there was, I think in high school, some kid walked up, got asked, teacher asked him a question, and he didn't want to answer. And you knew why, like, right away. And I went to an all-guy school, so, like, everyone, like, instantly is going to rip you apart forever.
Yeah.
So it's kind of easier to do it at all-guy school, though, because no girls are going to see that. And he stood up and just had a fucking rock-hard boner. And he went up to the board and answered the goddamn question and walked back.
I respect that.
Yeah. He was like, well, if you're going to make me do it, here we go.
I respect that.
All right.
Pitch that tent. All right. Next up, here's the headline. Chinese national Yuji Mali Zhao attended Stanford after her billionaire father paid $6.5 million in college admission scandal. What the fuck?
Yeah, $500,000 went to the sailing team head coach because that's how she got in, was through the...
Competitive sailing team.
Yeah, so she said she was a sailor. And then the other six went to... $6 million, not $600,000, went to a Morgan Stanley... some guy at Morgan Stanley that's been running all this. And then he probably divvied it out to everyone at the school.
That's $6 million too much.
I mean, that's fucking ridiculous.
What happened? Like, all these people are getting caught up in these scandals. What happened in the good old days? Like, I used to work in development. I used to work in fundraising.
Yeah.
People donate money. Now, I never had any firsthand knowledge of it, but I'm pretty sure I knew how it worked.
Quinnipiac, people weren't donating what they donate to Stanford.
You weren't paying... If you donated $1 million to something, and this is everywhere in the world, everywhere, every college, if you donated $1 million to put your name on a building at most colleges, now not Yale and Harvard because they don't give a fuck about $1 million. They have a
or Stanford. Yeah,
they have a billion, that's billions of dollars. Yeah. But
Six just got her into the school.
What do you do? Like, what is just donate $1 million, put your name in a building, like, yeah, Stanford, and that's it, though, and you're in. Like, that's it. Your $1 million is paying for scholarships of all, everyone else they want to get in there. You're doing them a service.
And I feel like everyone
just give the school money.
A lot of people go to Stanford a lot of people don't graduate because they want to be like tech guys and like, you know, start their own business and fucking
take the
leave.
Spot of one of those people.
Yeah. It's pretty fucking incredible how much money they fucking paid.
Their fucking mascot's a tree, by the way.
It is a tree.
Which is so stupid.
The tree, yeah. There's some really good mascots out in California. Anteaters.
And that was before they were even stoners. That was just unironically. They were just like, we're going to be a tree.
Yeah, we can't think of fucking anything, but there's a lot of trees around here, so...
Well, not anymore in California.
There were a lot of trees out there when Stanford was first started. The other thing is the schools are not getting...
Money for
indicted?
It.
No, they are
the schools.
Yeah, so it's going.
The schools weren't getting the money either. So like,
they say they're not, but it's going through a Morgan Stanley manager, and then going,
funneling the money back.
They'll figure
school.
It out that it's going into the school. Like, there's no way it's like you're not getting in because you hand it to some guy that's a money guy at Morgan
Stanley.
That's
true. He's got
to
give someone something.
Something. Somebody's getting something, and the schools. No schools are getting caught for this. It's been going on for fucking ever.
Maybe
though, so
she
it's
was
not,
an expert sailor.
Yeah, I mean, this is and when kids complain like, "Oh, I didn't get in," and this person got in, it's like, "This is what happens, man. This
yeah,
is called
you know
life.
What happens. Yeah,
this is called life.
These it people happens. Are just doing it illegally.
That's how
everyone
politics
else does
works.
It, everyone else does it legally.
That's how so fucking politics works.
Get over
you,
yourself.
You pay the guy that's run that wins the race to. Promote your stuff or not to shut your shit down. Like the NRA just pays fucking everybody.
Yeah. Welcome to the world, millennials, you little douchey kids.
Fucking pieces of shit. All right. That was good.
Last one. I don't have the headline up here.
What the fuck?
Oh. The BLT.
What's the BLT?
I don't know. That was one you
said. Oh. Yeah. So, guy on death row, they told. Let everyone know what he ate.
Oh, I had death row meal. That was separate.
Oh, so BLT is separate.
I have the death row meal. Hold on. I have that headline.
Okay.
We don't have to do BLT.
Okay. All right. Well, what's BLT?
I don't know.
What did I send you?
You didn't send me anything. You just said put BLT on there.
When did I say that?
I don't know. We were sitting down over there.
Fuck, I'm hungover, huh?
Wait, let's do this one. We'll wrap it up anyway.
Okay.
All right. Last headline we got here. Death row murderer has final dinner of two chicken and waffle meals and a pint of butter pecan ice cream before receiving a lethal injection for killing his ex-girlfriend and her friend. Bonesy?
That sounds great.
What would your last meal be?
Oh, I feel like it would be way more than that. Like, there must be a limit. There has to be a limit on what you can get.
I wonder if there's a place limit or a dollar limit.
Yeah, I mean.
Like, because in modern technology, I would just go on Grubhub and I would order up like a storm from many places.
Many different places, like seven different things. I would go, I'm going to get a slice from Tony Bologna's.
All right, I could respect
not Tony Bologna's, Penny Tedino. Sorry,
there's no. Oh, name. Woof.
No, just fucking around.
You want to dive salmonella before?
No, maybe. Yeah, might be a better way to go out. probably, maybe a pie from Johnny Pepperoni's, like with the pepperoni on top, a square pie.
Delicious, delicious.
They like the pepperoni's so fucking crispy; it's unbelievable.
You're wrong already in the pizza. It's basil's. I've got to go, but
no,
continue.
Basil's
continue.
Not going on there. I'll probably get a steak from Spark Steakhouse.
Okay.
I don't know.
Any turf to go with your surf?
No, or I mean, I'm not.
Surf to go with your turf?
You think vegetables or anything? Oh, you want fish. You're saying fish?
No, vegetables in your last meal. Are you kidding me?
Fuck, yeah. I'd probably, what's like the best sushi place in New York? I'd probably get that chef to come and fucking make me sushi. Like,
a delicious
like
meal.
At the table. Dude, and those, like, I haven't really eaten sushi since I went to like a place that was $100 for like a full omakase meal.
You got spurled.
Dude, I can't. Like, sushi is just not good anymore unless I spend a lot of money on it. There's no point in eating it. I'm like, this is just
sushi
bad.
Is pretty much sushi to me.
No, no. You think that. Everything other than these, the omakase style, where you pay like 200 fucking bucks for like an hour and a half, is the same. Yes.
You bougie-ass motherfucker.
Wait. Dessert. What would you... I think for dessert... I'm not a dessert guy.
Tartufo.
Oh, the Tartufo.
Love Tartufo. Nice little chocolate shell with the vanilla and the chocolate right in the middle. I got a little cherry.
I got a good one. Marie's.
Never been.
Marie's in Chatham, New Jersey.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful woman. Wonderful co-owner and husband, Carl.
Love you, Marie.
They made a cannoli once for, like, literally went there for lunch.
How do you pronounce it?
A cannoli. I got
a ganol.
Yeah, and it was, they just gave it to us for free. It was fresh out of the fuck, like literally freshly made, and it was
cream fraiche.
I don't think I will ever have a better cannoli. Like, I don't think that was the best thing I've ever had. And that was after
would
eating.
Would you say it's a top 10, maybe even top 2 cannoli?
Maybe
of all
even
time?
Top 2. Yeah, maybe top 2. That. Yeah. What about you? You're going Tartufo, that's right.
Tartufo. A basil slice.
Basil slice and Tartufo. That's it. What about that?
Mozzarella sticks have got to be a staple.
Yeah, like a fucking platter.
A nice mozzarella and carrots or a mozzarella stick from where? I don't know. It doesn't really matter to me.
No. You ever had the mozzarella from Whitney, Eli's on Whitney? They're triangles and they're covered in pesto.
Mozzarella and carrots. Oh, the pesto.
Oh my God. It is. That's the best fucking
mozzarella. I'm throwing out a curveball here. It's not the best mozzarella stick out there, but Arby's makes delicious mozzarella sticks.
That's not possible.
It
shut the fuck up.
Swear to God,
you're wrong.
Delicious.
You're wrong.
Give me a basil slice, not Arby's mozzarella stick, but I need like red sauce from somewhere better, like a nice Italian restaurant.
Oh, you need a real good red sauce. Oh, no.
The Arby's marinara sauce,
not even marinara. You need to get Marie because they use
we're going back to Marie and Carl.
They use vodka sauce as a condiment, and it is fucking
like sauce does that too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, sauce. Fuck. Yeah. Remember, I almost had you eating a carb on carb.
Almost
did, yeah. Okay.
Took it off. All right.
Are we done?
I think that's... all right, Bonesy, I think that's all we got for today.
Okay.
Want to end up the show with a nice little shout-out to a couple people. You got anyone you want to shout-out?
To my mother. I always love you, mother.
My mother.
To my mother. To Carly for actually being quite nice today.
Carly was great.
Yeah, she's been sleeping now for another like 20 minutes or so. Who else do I want to shout out? I want to shout out Benny Tedino's for having the best big slice out there.
Respect.
Rest in peace, Benny. We'll miss you.
Don't agree with you, but I respect you.
Yeah, and shout out to our friend Roberto for calling in today.
Thank you, Robert.
That was nice of him. Really great. Would you rather? Yeah, hypothetical situation there.
All right, my few shout-outs here. Let's go, Gaga. Quick recovery. Love you, boo-boo. my HK boy, Murph! Ian, wish I was with you and the boys. Love you. The Bobs. Future wardrobes provided by MJD Accounting Firm. Angelo, see you, boo-boo. Baby Luca, I'll see you in two. Baby Luca. That's all I got, Bonesy.